Yeah, bet. We go to Blaze at. That's right. Yeah, yeah.
Ride with me.
Yeah.
Walk a block with me.
Welcome to the latest installment of An Extraordinary Recap. It is your boy, Jay Connor.
And this is Alex Hardy.
And this season, we're recapping every single episode of HBO's smash hit, Insecure. And tonight, we're joined by some extended family members of mine, DJ Blackshaw, the Count, B Fierce, and a frequent guest of ours, Miss Jazz Hands. But if your podcast game is on point, you might know them as the crew behind the podcast, The Brown Liquor Report. So thank y'all for coming through.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Finally, we get to form Voltron and have all of us on the same show.
I know, right?
I know I've stole Jazz a few times.
I'm 12 of y'all niggas.
I'm gonna get a rotation going and just start taking turns with y'all. But I don't think people realize that, you know, while everyone else is out like turning up at pool parties and barbecues, some of us had to sacrifice for the greater good and bang out these recaps and stay our ass home. So I appreciate y'all sobering up in time to come on the show.
I know.
Sober?
Yeah. Okay.
Wait, we're supposed to be sober?
Sober.
It's like Brown Liquor Report.
I mean, right. Nope. Mm-mm. Nope. I don't know. I'll let you know in the morning whether I'm sober or not. I really don't know anymore.
All right. Now, in tonight's episode, we got a lot going on. So we'll start with Molly, who begins the episode unsure of where her relationship with both her firm and Dro is going. But when she attempts to renegotiate her salary at the firm, they shut her down and tell her to wait for her annual review, even though she points out that they've made exceptions in the past with other partners. Is this work dynamic doomed to fail? We'll let you go first, Alex.
Yes, I think that her being in that environment, she's constantly going to be in a position of having to prove herself and go above and beyond and show how great and wonderful she is when everyone else will just have their accomplishments or not praised and rewarded with raises and promotions without as much effort. So I think it's all going to work out. I think it's not going to work out for her in the end. I think she's always going to be in a place of disadvantage in that corporate environment as the black woman in the office. So I don't know what's going to happen, but it's all going to be an uphill battle.
Yeah, yeah. I know Jazz got something to say about this. So get it off, Jazz.
She's got,
get cooking, Jazz.
I feel like she's got to go. She shot her shot. She called everybody to the table. She made a great case for herself. And they were like, nah, we'll talk about it next year. So even if she, you know, even if she stays, now she's just marked as like this person who's expecting more. And I just think it's not going to work out well for her.
The petulant child. What about you, Count?
I don't see it. I mean, she's the living embodiment of twice as much to get half, twice as good to get half as much. And yeah, like you said, she did everything she's supposed to do, taking up extra work they didn't even know about, taking on accounts they didn't even know about. And still they're like, well, I mean, how about next year? Next year? And she just
say
watched.
Next year.
She, next year, not next quarter. Yeah. Not next fiscal year, next year, like 2018.
Word.
Like, nah, nigga, you going through Christmas? You going through the holidays?
You getting your regular bonus.
The ill thing is they didn't say that it was like a year from now. I mean, it could have been anywhere within 2018. You know what I'm saying? Like, it could be Christmas next year. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
You know, I kind of felt like, you know, if she was going to go to the table and, you know, lay out her cards on the table, she should have been ready to walk. She smiled when they gave her that answer. Yeah. And at that point in negotiation, you'd be like, look, this is what I want. Because she never actually just comes out and says, give me what I want.
Right.
She just lays all her accomplishments on the table and expects somebody to just offer it to her. And I think that's one of the things is she doesn't ask for what she wants. And so she doesn't get it.
So if you were in that situation, how would you go about it differently?
I've been
as a strong black woman,
know,
a strong light skinned black woman.
Situation. I told the people to their face, I don't work for free. You gonna pay me like you pay everybody else. I put up the numbers, and it's not it's a non-starter.
I think the only chance she has to climb at this company is that she has to learn some serious dirt on the
somebody gonna get fired.
She gotta learn some dirt. If not, she's gotta go. And, you know, possibly start her own thing or go to a place that's a little more inclusive.
Like she has to find out who the coke plug is for the partner.
Listen.
She pleading for fairness.
Huh?
She's pleading. Like, she's coming to the table. She's asking for somebody for equity. Like, the minute that you come to the table asking them for that, and you're not ready to walk away.
You've lost.
That knowledge of the dirt gets you a long way.
I feel like that would be a cop out though, like story wise, if like she finds out some dirt and they're like, oh, okay, we'll give you, you know, as opposed to getting an increase in your salary because of your merit, we'll give it to you because of some dirt. Like, I really hope it doesn't unfold like that. You know what I'm saying? Because really, that would be bogus as shit.
I don't either.
Like, it wouldn't allow the conversation to be broader, you know, about, like you said, like about equity and being a woman of color in that kind of space. Nah, it would be a good episode, but.
Yeah, I certainly don't think the storyline will go that way, in that direction. But
that would be
I'm just saying in real world.
That would be the standard sitcom ending, and Insecure has done. They've always kind of undercut the standard sitcom ending.
Word. So
Insecure was a white run production, like that type of storyline might be more plausible. But I think in this case, they're definitely going to have her excel based on if she does excel there, based on her, you know, her representing her skill.
All right. Now, on the love front, things with Dro get more complicated when Molly and Candace finally come face to face at Derek's birthday dinner party. Though Molly and Candace are cordial, Dro clearly shows her way more attention as Molly is awkwardly forced to sit alone and kind of watch them and take that all in. So when Dro takes a bathroom break and Molly confronts him on feeling expendable, it ends in more sexual impropriety. But still not happy with how this dynamic will play out in the future, Molly calls her moms to ask why she stayed with her dad after he cheated. Her mother reveals that she stayed because she loved him and he, quote unquote, made her feel special more than he hurt her. Damn. So not wanting to repeat her mother's mistakes, Molly shuts things down with Dro. So is it possible to have an open relationship in which all parties involved are 100% happy? Let's start with Blackshaw this time.
100% of no.
100% I mean, happy.
No, absolutely not. Maybe initially, but as that time goes, somebody's going to feel slighted. Somebody's going
to
feel hurt.
Tell your wife not to be so greedy, bro. What you think, B-Fierce?
No, I think open relationships are possible, but I think that people have to be honest about where they are emotionally. Like, she never went into that in a really whole, strong space. Like, she just continues to ping pong from one end of the room to the other, from one dude to the next. And so when she ran into him, you know, she tried to pretend like she was in this evolved space where she could handle this. But I mean, she's just not being honest with herself. She never is. So she caught feelings and now she's messed up again. Yeah.
Can we confirm that Dro is really in an open relationship?
He's lying.
You know?
That nigga lying, Joe.
That nigga's lying. You know?
Yeah, that nigga whole lying. I'm going to walk out and you walk out after me thing was a bit of a clue for me. That maybe.
He's lying. That's game.
Yeah.
Like, he's tall.
That big mouth bass nigga is lying.
He's really tall. He's really fucking, like, this episode, I know he's really fucking tall.
He's like 6'20".
Is that an ending?
Yo, speaking from personal experience, being tall and having facial hair will get you very far in life. So Dro is living his best life. Alex, what you got on this situation?
Yeah, I definitely think it's possible to be happy in an open relationship. I think that communication is definitely paramount, both not just what you expect out of it, but as far as like the boundaries. I think that fucking in the bathroom when your wife is in the next room was kind of wilding out here. I feel like Molly set herself up for failure, and I don't think it can't possibly end well, you know, with her obviously being a little wrapped up more emotionally and not kind of ready for that dynamic of having their marriage, you know, presented with her in that way. They're happy marriage, and she just turned at the end of the table trying to chime in, getting talked over like a loser. So is it going to end up bad for her?
Now, Jazz Hands, is Molly really over Dro, or is this going to turn into a situation in which he's forbidden fruit?
It probably will turn into a situation where it's forbidden fruit, because I think she's really attracted to the way he makes her feel special, and I think she hasn't really reconciled her feelings about, you know, what she expects in a relationship. And as long as she's able to go from high to high, then she's good. Molly's got issues.
Niggas got issues, yo.
Every single one of them.
Everybody got issues. What you got, Count?
Oh, Molly? This is just not. this just isn't. No, I don't believe it. She needs more people. She needs so many more people. Just no. She needs so many more people because she when has she exhibited any type of stable emotional behavior? If she could get her personal life lined up and diligent like her professional life, then she'd be killing the game. But even that isn't even really hitting on all cylinders. So the same way that she can't ask for what she really wants in her professional life is the same way she can't ask for what she wants in her personal life.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
So it mirrors. She's like, oh, you know, hey, this is everything I got. Oh, you don't want to give it to me? Okay, fine. And then, yeah, she'll go, you know, get her back blown out in the bathroom, but she won't say, you know what? I don't want to do this like this. She sends up a text message. And you know she's going to answer that text message when it comes back. Yeah. So, nah.
So do we all agree that Candace has no idea what's going on with Molly? Or does anybody feel that she's in on this being an open relationship?
Absolutely not.
Nope.
Mm-mm. I don't think she knows, but she might gag Molly in the next episode with, you know, a slick. So, how's it going fucking my husband? Or how does my pussy taste? She might whip that out.
I honestly don't think she knows.
No,
I think she does.
I think the body language was just very interesting throughout that dinner party because it was very clear that he was like, this is my woman. You stay over there. You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't any kind of like balancing act or anything like that. He wasn't trying to juggle at all. He was just like, oh, okay, well, you got to sit over there. Cool. Stay your ass over there. I'm going to play my position over here and hold this down.
Molly put the spot up following him to the bathroom, though.
She did. And that's probably what's going to be the impetus for Candace being like, so how's my pussy taste? No, but so they've been sowing seeds for weeks now. But is Lil Rel going to slide in with a bag of popcorn and sweep Molly off her feet?
Yep. I hope so. Remember Wait and Exhale when Layla Rashawn got with the guy from The Wire, Bunk from The Wire?
Yeah.
That's what I feel like is going to happen with Lil Rel. I really feel like he's going to make a move on her.
I got a body like a preacher.
Right. Yeah, I got a pastor's body. I got a pastor's body. Yeah, that was good stuff. All right, now, on the Lawrence front, Aparna and Lawrence are making a conscious decision to keep their blossoming relationship a secret from their coworkers. Have any of you been in a situation in which you dated a coworker?
Don't shit with you.
Tell all your business.
Dated.
Dated. She's like, how do you quantify the word date?
Yeah. Right.
Define
date. Date.
You mean like seen in public?
Have you been involved with a coworker?
Yeah.
Let's hear it. I know y'all got some stories.
Yes.
What was that experience like? Because I'm here for these stories and so is our listeners.
You know, at another place and time, in a galaxy far, far away, it was awkward. Because I think after a while, people started to kind of pick up on it, be clued in. Like, I thought I was mad clever and, you know, nobody would know. But people probably knew. Wasn't that much one-on-one conversation in the world.
Was it a subordinate or like a manager?
Peer.
A peer, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Those extended bathroom breaks?
Right, this is well before people started trying to promote me. When I was still trying to get myself together. You
okay.
Know? But yeah, no, it was, it's a bad idea. Just generally,
it's a horrible idea.
Yeah, it's a bad idea. Like, yeah, I won't. Yeah. Now, I wouldn't even date in DC, I don't think.
Alex is out the whole city.
Yeah, no, I'm good.
Alex, you said that you've dated a coworker?
Yeah.
Who at Ebony did you mess with?
Yeah.
And did you write about it? Yes or no?
Wait,
go ahead.
I didn't actually. This was actually 100 years ago, back when I was a fisherman. When I was a fisherman, back when I was playing for Team Bisexual, like when I was.
Oh.
Awesome.
Yo, that's good stuff. Go ahead.
Wow. It was a coworker at Chuck E.
Cheese. This nigga was really on the boat.
Writers.
It was the last time playing in the vaginal waters. And after that, we ended up, basically had a whole other boyfriend at her high school across town. And that was the end of that. And but it doesn't matter. I was out here being a hoe anyway. So anyway, it worked out fine.
Shout out to fishermen. I actually have been in two situations in which I was involved with coworkers. And ironically enough, they were my last two girlfriends. So how does that, I guess that ended unfavorably or favorably, depending upon how you look at it. But
are they listening?
One of them might be, although she's mad at me right now, so we're not talking. But
stapler. She want a stapler back.
It was a red swing line stapler.
Yeah. Yo, no, but the older one, Nikki, we were like actively coworkers, and we were trying to be like sneaky and like not let people know. But the other one, we were coworkers, but we didn't become romantically involved until after we weren't working together anymore. So I guess I could only say like one time it happened, but yeah. So, but it's work, yo. It's work. Go ahead.
So when the one went south, right, and you all were still coworkers, like what happened? Was it awkward? Like, did you not sit with each other at the, each other at lunch anymore? Like, was it awkward in meetings? Was it like talking over, like passive aggressive? Like, no, I don't think that's a good idea.
Well, this is
manifest.
It actually kind of ended. It actually kind of ended in like heartbreak because she ended up realizing, or she had some like family problems going on because she was from Missouri. And she had some family issues going on with like what's going on out there. I hear y'all niggas laughing. She had some family. She had some family issues going on.
I was waiting for you to say like Syria.
He said Missouri.
Missouri. Like it's so it's the it's the same distance. It is. It's the same distance.
Exotic lands.
It is
Missouri.
But she had to. But she had to go home.
Okay.
She had to move home and she ended up like being on some like, so I guess this isn't going to work anymore because I'm moving. And she didn't tell me until like a week before she was about to move. And then she left my key to my apartment in my work, in my work mailbox.
Oh, damn.
Oh, no. Oh,
damn. She living foul.
She's from Missouri.
Yeah, they knew that.
Different things happen.
I hope she's listening. Shout out to you, Nikki. I hope you're doing all right. No, they do, anyway.
They do things differently out there.
Hurt his feelings.
Now, also on the Lawrence front, we learned that Lawrence blocked Issa on Facebook. So what are the proper rules of engagement when it comes to exes and social media? We'll start with Alex.
Depends on your relationship. If it ended bitterly, then I think it's best for everybody that you unfollow or at least block to save yourself. Shit, you don't need to see. You know, especially if it ended tragically, they're out here flourishing and traveling and getting love and getting sex on the regular and getting their ass eaten and shit. And you out here miserable.
On Facebook.
Damn.
On Facebook. That's new. Mm. I mean, some of these groups out here. So.
Mm. Count, what is your stance on exes and social media?
Sever all ties. Complete. All of it. Block. You don't exist to me anymore. Time and distance. Like, I'm unfollowing you in every possible way. We ain't friends no more. I don't know you.
Dying of fire.
Dying of fire. It's like T.I. and ATL. I don't want to kick it with you. I don't want to know you. None of that shit. Why? What for? What for? Why? I'm for my own, like Alex said, for my own personal mental health, I don't need to see you. I don't need to talk to you. I don't need to talk to anybody to talk to you. Nah, you dead to me. Even if dying of fire. Even broke if, my heart. I mean, fuck you.
I mean, every relationship doesn't end that way, though. Like, sometimes it's mutual and
please
and,
hug him.
It's mutual and amicable and
if it's mutual and amicable, I still don't need to see you.
Who hurt you?
I'm just saying, like,
is
I don't
she
need
no
to
hurt people. Hurt people.
I don't need to see you. Okay. Like, I don't need to. Like, we broke up. I don't need to see you because all that's going to do is draw me back in, and we broke up for a reason. Even if it wasn't, you broke my heart. It was like, you know what? This isn't working out. If I keep seeing you on a regular basis in my timeline, I'm be like, man, we were good friends, though. I mean, we parted as friends. So, I mean,
true.
Come on, girl. Let's just go get some lunch. And then we back at it again. Nah. Clean breaks.
It's kind of cool if they start looking bad, though.
She's so petty.
That's fine.
Jazz, what you got as far as exes and social media?
I think you gotta take it down bare bones. It depends on how fresh the breakup is. Depends on if it was amicable or not. But, you know, mostly I don't really need to see you either. And what's funny is that Lawrence blocked her not because of anything she did. He blocked her secondarily. Like, someone else posted a photo of you and tagged you, and I had to see it. So, yeah, I think you just gotta do what you gotta do.
All right, now let's get on to the get down. Let's talk about Issa. Daniel calls to apologize for spewing his seed in Issa's face, but fucks up when he says they're even now, which sends Issa into a rage and she demands that he never speak to her again. Now, clearly he handled this wrong, but knowing how sensitive this topic is, what would have been the proper course of action? I'll start with Alex.
You mean as far as notification of incoming skeet to the face?
That's a good place to start. Incoming.
I just feel like, well, I mean, as far as that, it's a job risk. I mean, you know, notification. I mean, yeah, you know, if you got to have that discussion ahead of time, especially if you're averse to it, don't come in my mouth. Let me know before you bust the nut. Like that's, you know, but as far as them being even, he's absolutely right. She got her feelings hurt dramatically and stormed out. And that's how he felt when she told him that he was just an itch that she needed to scratch. So you fuck me over, I fuck you over. Even though his was not, I don't think, as big of a deal as, you know, telling somebody that they ain't shit to you. But, you know, get what you put out.
Be fierce, what you got?
I think, you know, she's problematic for me. Just in general, she started getting on my nerves midway through season one. You know, she went in, right? And there are certain things that come with the territory, but she can only ever, you know, see things through her lens, like how it impacts her. It's about her, you know, and how she interpreted it. Like, you know, this is kind of the hazards of the job, like you said. So taking it that way, like, you know, you embarrassed me. Like, you putting a little too much on that, mama. I just felt like she went way too far with that.
It was, yeah.
It was extra. It was
he certainly didn't do it on purpose.
I mean, I think it's a sign of doing a good job.
But that, yeah.
Right.
That,
it's a complimentary.
And you never know where
surprise.
That's, you never know where that stuff's going to go.
I mean, this is like one of those things.
You never know what's going
to
go.
She's giving him way too much credit to be like, you did this to me. I really didn't. But, happened.
It just speaks to that it wasn't about him. It wasn't mm-hmm. for him. It right. was for her.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, yeah. And it's always on her terms, what works for her. She's just incredibly selfish and annoying.
Jazz, what you got?
Is there a better way that Daniel could have went about having that conversation? That was
yes.
Question, right? Yes. I don't even understand why he was having that conversation. I don't understand why he was calling to apologize outside of the fact of, you know, I'm sorry that you're upset. You know, like that's concerning to me. Let's move past it. But I don't feel like he necessarily did anything wrong by completing. Like, I don't understand yeah. how she got to this point where him having an orgasm during sex and coming in her face is like a bad thing. So unless she just didn't want to swallow and then. You know, he did it on purpose or something.
But that's a different discussion.
That's a totally yes. different
that's
discussion.
That's a whole different
and
discussion.
And I feel like maybe that's the discussion that they needed to have just around this whole oral sex thing, period. I think that was the whole, like, offense thing or maybe the thing that was being judged and why she finds this, like, as such an affront to her. Like, oh, my goodness.
So basically you're saying that they should have signed, like, a dick prenup before she sucked it is what you're saying.
If it was uncharted territory for her, they should have. I mean, she tried to show out. And she just got out of her league. Like,
yeah.
That kind of kills the mood, though. Like,
all right. Now we get to the dinner party, which is awkward as shit, obviously. And Issa is clearly not feeling Lawrence being there with another woman. She eventually storms out and her and Lawrence go in on each other outside. He calls her out for still fucking with Daniel after doing so ruin their relationship. And she returns fire by calling him out for fucking her and Tasha at the same time. Then she hits him where it hurts by clowning his app, to which she says, was it worth all that time I spent supporting your depressed ass? Which leads to his jaw-dropping counter. Probably not as much time as you spent being a fucking hoe. The episode concludes with Issa finally reaching her breaking point as she tears up her apartment. What did you guys think when you saw that last scene? We'll start with Alex.
First of all, ain't no nigga worth tearing up your own apartment. ain't no type amount of strife in the world that warrants that. I think that, yeah, they both crossed the line. They both said some shit that they should not have said. You know, I think it pointed to her comment about him being depressed, definitely pointed to like a lot of unsaid things, obviously, between them about, you know, their relationship and his mood and what the fuck happened and what didn't happen. And of course, he had to shame her into, you know, moving on. Well, actually, no, she did cheat. But I think calling her a hoe definitely was crossing the line. And he just wanted to hurt her, you know, to feel some of what he felt. I'm sure they'll both take back all of what they said. But again, I think that Issa is, if she's not evicted, she's going to definitely regret fucking up her own apartment because that shit was crossing the line.
All right, what you got, Blackshaw?
Let me think.
We'll come back to you. Count, what you got?
I think they this was the opportunity they had to pull the knives out. Like, this was the things they've been thinking about. Clearly, you know, Issa talks to herself in the mirror. This was like, I think this was the first confirmation we've had that Lawrence was actually depressed. And the fact that she used that against him in the pejorative. Like, you know, I was taking care of your depressed ass. Like that hurt. That yeah. she did that to hurt
like
him.
Like taking care of.
Like that hurt. And everything he did was reflexive. But he's still like, yeah, I blocked you so I don't have to see you with the dude that ruined our relationship. Mm-hmm. Like, that makes sense. That's a logical choice. It's
act of self-preservation.
That's his act of self-preservation. But mm-hmm. she took it as, oh, you being petty. Mm-hmm. Why would I want to see pictures of you and a dude that you were fucking that ruined our relationship? Like, why would I want to see that?
She's got no pause.
None.
She's got no pause.
None.
Yeah, she can't.
You know. None. And she's so selfish and self-absorbed and wrapped up in all of her. I'm gonna be a hoe. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do that. Okay. Well, when he puts it back in your face, because to him, you're being a hoe didn't start with when we broke up. That was when you started fucking Daniel.
Mm. Well, I mean, the last time somebody put something in her face, she didn't take it too well, so she might want to fall back.
But
Jazz, what you got?
Well, one thing is that, you know, when she took the jab at him and said, you know, mentioned his depression, mm-hmm. when people don't really have a good understanding of mental illness and mental mm-hmm. health, they only can take certain symptoms, certain presentations as offensive. For mm-hmm. her to be there supporting him and helping him and that not to be the remedy, to like motivate him in a way that could promote some kind of balance or him getting back out there, like that's a personal affront to some people. And mm-hmm. it's not necessarily healthy, a healthy perspective, but it's one nonetheless. I mean, I think that's why she just lobbed that big old Molotov cocktail, was like, you're depressed, guys. But it is obvious that they just have a lot of emotions and feelings for each other that they really need to flesh out, because they're still in positions where they're able to hurt one another with their words. So mm-hmm. you need to process, you know, what you're feeling, how you got there, and like have a real conversation about it and not just be on the side of the street taking jabs at each other.
Yeah. Blackshaw, are these two even healthy for each other?
I think eventually they could be. Certainly not right now. I think they both definitely need some therapy. Mm. It's just, you know, maybe, you know, once they're healed and things like that, maybe it can work out, or maybe not.
They're insecure.
Certainly. Yeah. Yeah. So maybe in the future, you know, I'm still kind of rooting for them after all this. I think, you know, there are some things that are definitely salvageable, but just they ain't ready right now.
Alex, what do you think should be Issa's steps, or first step rather, in order to heal properly over all this? Because obviously this is a culmination of her relationship with Lawrence, as well as the consequences of her hotation. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think they just need to talk. They obviously have a lot of shit that they need to say to one another. I think that she's proving that maybe the hotation really isn't the healthiest thing for her. I mean, it probably feels good and cathartic in the moment, but it's obviously not giving her any type of fulfillment. So I think maybe she needs to fall back. She's making a lot of wild choices, you know, as far as rolling up on people's houses unannounced and shit like that. So I think she needs to sit her ass the fuck down for a minute and regroup and just figure what the fuck she really, really, really needs and wants to do.
I mean, it's not her. It's not even her. It's like she's really bad at it. She's really
she
bad at it.
It's not her at all. It's not her.
It's not her. Like chill. You know, and I think she will. I hope.
Yeah. All right. Now, Jazz. Was Lawrence wrong for bringing Aparna knowing that Issa would be there?
Fuck yeah.
What?
Lawrence gets... I'm sorry. Can I say that on your show?
Yes, you can.
Hell yeah.
Lawrence gets on my motherfucking nerves. I mean, Issa does too. But he really gets on my nerves because he really believes that what Issa has done to him just permits him to do whatever the fuck he wants to do. And he's beyond reproach. Why would you do that? Like, why would you do that? That's her scene, her friends. You have all this explaining to do. It's like they just take joy in producing their own trauma. It's like, I'm just going to fabricate something. I'm just going to create it, make it all up. I just thought that was the most ridiculous move to make. And I think it was a terrible and unfair introduction for homegirl, who seems like a pretty nice person.
I think you did make an excellent point about those being her friends. If it was like, you know, a neutral zone, you can make the argument that he's single, he can do what he wants, they're not together, it's whatever. But you going around her friends, yeah, that's a bit of a landmine. Count, what you got?
That was supremely stupid. like that was next level stupid. Mm. Aparna seems very cool. Hey, I got to go to this birthday party. Can I meet up with you later? Cool. They're trying to keep it casual. She says, hey, I can come with you if it's easier. Nah, it might not be easier. Mm-mm. these are my ex's friends. Cool.
The end.
That was the end of that scene right there. There was no need. Like, if Lawrence were a friend of mine, I'm like, man, what are you doing? Are you serious? Are you serious? Are you trying to start a fight? Are you trying to be uncomfortable? What's wrong with you?
It was vindictive.
He's not self-led. You think that was his idea?
Yeah.
No. He's going along to get along.
He goes along to get along. He says, okay. You know, Tasha throwing it at him. He says, okay. Mm-hmm. He just goes with it.
That's that game.
Right.
I don't believe it.
I think he knows exactly
what he's doing just so he can always be like, well, I didn't. I was just in the book. Shut up, Lawrence. Shut up.
Shut your mouth. No, I mean,
Alex, was Lawrence wrong for bringing Aparna?
Well, even if it weren't his ex, you don't bring a plus one for dinner party like that. But yes, he definitely was, knowing that she would have been there. It was provocative, even though he can go under there in the guise of like, oh, if we're just friends, that didn't mean anything. No, it was, you know, it was gonna, she's in her feelings. You obviously know she's an emotional, not even emotional, but she reacts in that kind of, you know, that way, like she did outside. It was a bad move, bad call.
But partially in his defense, he was under the assumption that she was still fucking with Daniel, which technically she is. So she might have showed up with Daniel. Would she have been right to show up with Daniel and he not show up with somebody?
I think
she's gonna go into the war zone. You need backup. You know what I'm saying?
She would have been wrong showing up with Daniel, because it's not like her friends don't know who he is. Like, that would have been equally as awkward. Like, you bring in a nigga that broke up your relationship that you're still dealing with. Like we're all like, oh yeah, girl, you on your vacation, but we all know you're still fucked up over it. And you bringing this nigga around, like, for real? It would have been just as bad as like, nah, that's not okay.
I don't think she would have, because she was already trying to distance herself from him, like a few episodes ago, or last episode. Yeah, a couple episodes.
Daniel wouldn't have come.
But he already did.
All right. So anybody got any other thoughts?
Group dinners are terrible.
Yes.
They are of the devil.
They are of the devil.
That shit was so awkward, yo. It was so awkward. All right. So thank you all for coming through. How can people listen to your podcast and find you on these internet streets?
You can find us on them face pages. The Brown Liquor Report. You can find us on Instagram.
At Brown Liquor Report.
SoundCloud, search Brown Liquor Report. You can hit our Patreon page to donate, because the ratchet is free, but the liquor ain't.
You real.
We're on Twitter at B Liquor Report.
Yeah.
No Brown, just a B Liquor Report, because we, you know, not enough character. We couldn't put a lot of characters in it. They bounced the bed. They were like, nah, nigga.
But you can also come to our webpage, brownliquorreport.com, search us, find us, put us in the Googles, and you can come listen. Come join us, pull something out. Enjoy yourself.
Yeah, we have a ball doing this.
Y'all niggas are long-winded as fuck. Jesus Christ. Jesus. All right, Alex, how can people find us?
You can find us at theextraordinarynegroes.com. You can also find us on the Twitters at The Extra Negroes, same thing on Instagram, and on Facebook at The Extraordinary Negroes. And you can also find us on Patreon, patreon.com/TheExtraordinary, The Extra Negroes. Ta-da.
So yes, thank you all for listening. And again, if you love what you're hearing tonight, please check out The Brown Liquor Report. Their podcast is dope. I've been on there. Alex hasn't, because he's not important. But yeah, check them out. So thanks again. Peace.